I used to love the film Titanic. The last 45 minutes or so, after the sex scene in the car, when the seawater starts to flow, the sinking ship all slopping and swaying, the band how they keep on playing, a man dressing up as a girly waif to hide in a boat and get himself safe, the human catastrophe, the chaos, the panic, the drama. I used to love that film Titanic, all that melodrama. But now it just looks like the Channel 4 news. People grabbing for life jackets with no coat and no shoes. Now I'm just reminded of the plight of refugees. All those human beings drowning in the open seas. People hungry and cold in overcrowded boats. Crying for help with salt-burned throats. There's a Syrian Leo and there's Kate the Kurd. I used to like that film Titanic, but now it looks absurd. And my love will go on. It's a terrible song. I said I used to like the film Titanic, not Celine Dion. I used to like that film Titanic. I used to like that film Titanic. But now it just looks like the Channel 4 news. People grabbing for life jackets with no coat and no shoes. Now I'm just reminded of the plight of refugees. All those human people drowning in the open seas. People hungry and cold in overcrowded boats, crying for help with salt-burned throats. Hungry and cold in overcrowded boats, crying for help with salt-burned throats. I used to like that film Titanic. I used to like that film Titanic.
جلبنا معنا جثة أفغانية نصف عارية سحبتها مع عادل سليم 3 ليال قاسية في غابة بدت بلا نهاية ومخرج نزع عادل قميص الأفغاني الأسود وربطت أنا قدميه بأكمام القميص كانت آخر غابة على الحدود الرومانية الهنغارية بعد 10 أمتار تمزق القميص سحبناه من ذراعيه هذه المرة كانت الثلوج تهطل بعد أن عبرنا النهر نسيت كل هذا ظننت أنني نائم في سجن وحدتي العسكرية من أيام الحرب حين أفقنا فجرا شاهدنا كلاب الجيش الهنغاري تشوم جثة الأفغاني اسمك سالم حسين شقد عمرك 30 ثم أشرت بيده لأن أخلع لباسي الداخلي البارحة أخذوا الخرى اليوم يفتشون الجلد دونت ملاحظة في الأوراق التي أمامها ثم حركت إصبعها من أسفل إلى أعلى هذه المرة رفعت لباسي الداخلي بسطت يدها باتجاه الباب من دون أن تلتفت إلي ارتديت بقية ملابسي دخل بعدي عادل سليم ثم شاب نيجيري طويل اسمه جيمس كان يرتدي شورتا صيفيا قصيرا طبعت على مؤخرته شمس ضاحكة مع قميص خفيف بألوان علم جامايكا احتج على مرافقتنا التي لم تسمح له بالخروج لتدخين سجارة لم يبقى سوى المغربي وعجوز كردي مع زوجته كنا مجموعة نزلاء جدد وصلنا في الصباح في ساعة مبكرة إلى المستشفى برفقة شابة جميلة تدعى أنيس من محطة استقبال اللاجئين هي ألبانية عينت في المحطة بعد أن قامت فيها 5 سنوات كلاجئة. تعلمت خلالها اللغة الهنغارية بطلاقة. في يد كل واحد منا علبة خرة وأنبوب بلاستيكي للبول. نهض المغربي وفك حزام بنطاله قليلا وحشر قميصه الرياضي الأحمر، ثم أحكم إغلاق الحزام بشكل مضحك. خرج جيمس النيجيري من غرفة الطبيب منتشيا وهو يشد خيط سرواله الشمسي. بدا وكأنه خارج للتو من غرفة عاهرة. نوهت آنس بأن الممرضة ستأتي بعد قليل لجمع علب الخرة وأنابيب البول، وتمنت أن تمر الاختبارات بسلام. كنت أنا وعادل سليم قد وصلنا بعد الآخرين ب3 أيام. أجروا معنا تحقيقا سريعا في مركز الجيش على الحدود، وفي الصباح أرسلونا إلى محطة استقبال اللاجئين في مدينة حدودية. لا أدري لين أخذوا جثة الأفغاني. أخبرونا أن الشرطة ودائرة الهجرة ستحقق معنا مرة أخرى عن تفاصيل موته بعد الفحوصات الطبية. أدخلونا إلى الحجر الصحي في محطة الاستقبال، وهو مبنى صغير ملحق ببناية المحطة الكبيرة حيث يعيش بقية النزلاء. الهنغار يسمون الحجر الصحي كما في العراق كارانتينا. كانت مزدحمة وقذرة، أفغان وعرب وأكراد وباكستانيين وسودانيين وبنغلاديش وأفارقة وبعض الألبان. تستمر الفحوصات مدة 1 شهر. رعب الكارانتينا بالنسبة للنزلاء الجدد يكمن في نتائج الاختبارات الطبية، فهناك من هو مسلول أو أجرب. هؤلاء يرحلون من الكارانتينا إلى مستشفى العزل في أطراف المدينة، يبقون هناك حتى يتم علاجهم، وهذا ما يخشاه أغلب النزلاء الجدد. خشيتهم ليست من المرض بل من فترة العلاج التي قد تمتد إلى أكثر من 1.5 عام. Thank you.
Dit zijn de namen. Ik heb het niet zelf gekozen, dit stukje. De chauffeur had ze de richting gewezen die ze moesten gaan, steeds naar het westen. 2-3 uur verderop wachtten ze de bewoonde wereld. Langs de wegen waren controles, wegversperringen. Het was beter om te voet aan te komen en zich dan te verspreiden door de stad. Slierte nevel dreven boven de vlakte. Niet veel later gloorde er een purperen streep licht aan de horizon achter hen. Het onvaste, zwevende paars van de ochtendschemering haalde ze in. Ze waren licht in hun hoofd van vermoeidheid en euforie. Ze waren onzeker en gelukkig. Niet lang meer en ze zouden de nieuwe wereld binnengaan. De zon werd de hemel ingecatapulteerd. De koelte van de ochtend week voor zijn ogenblikkelijke hitte. Geen van hen had nog water. Zwijgend liepen ze onder de hete, open hemel, hun ogen rood van het turen naar de horizon, waar hun dromen hardnekkig weigerden zich te materialiseren. Ze waren al veel langer aan het lopen dan de man gezegd had. De twijfel sloeg toe. Eerst stil, maar al vlug openlijk. "We zijn genaaid," schreeuwde een man. Zijn woorden werden met opluchting ontvangen. Nu konden ze zich afzetten tegen hun bangste gedachten. "Niet waar," zeiden ze, "we zijn alleen maar verkeerd gelopen. We moeten daarheen." En ze wezen alle kanten op. Alle praten nu door elkaar heen, hun oren nog slechts gespitst op geruststelling en bevestiging. "Wat heb je gezien?" vroegen ze de jongen. "Wat precies?" "Barakken," zei hij geschrokken, "de honden en soldaten. Ze hadden pistolen hier." Hij sloeg met zijn hand op zijn heup. "Wat nog meer?" "Lampen, auto's, weet ik veel." Hij was verlegen door alle ogen die op hem gericht waren. Zijn antwoord stelde ze gerust. Hij had een grens beschreven, geen twijfel mogelijk. De chauffeur had ze de verkeerde richting gewezen, dat was alles. "Opzettelijk," dacht de een. "Hij wist niet beter," zei de ander. Sommigen zeiden, "we moeten terug naar waar we vandaan komen, dan volgen we het spoor terug." Anderen bestreden dit. "We lopen al de hele dag. Als we gewoon rechtdoor blijven gaan, komen we vanzelf ergens aan." De zwarte man hield zich afzijdig van het gekrakeel. Hij staarde over de vlakte, zijn kin omhoog, alsof hij in de verte dingen zag aankomen die voor de anderen nog onzichtbaar waren. De jongen kon zijn ogen niet van hem afhouden. De Ethiopiër was de eerste van de wonderen die hem nog wachtten. Het kroezige haar van de zwarte man was grauw van het stof. Niemand wist hoe lang hij al onderweg was. Had hij zelf enig idee waar hij naartoe ging? Wie wees hem de weg? En hoe was hij in hun gezelschap terechtgekomen? Met elke nieuwe vraag die hij opriep, verdiepte zich het raadsel. Hij was een sprookjesfiguur, een geheimzinnige zwerver. Maar of hij een goede of een slechte kracht was, wist de jongen niet. Achter hem werd geschreeuwd. Verder gaan of teruggaan, daarop spitste alles zich toe. Een paar mannen liepen demonstratief in westelijke richting. "Daar is niks," riepen ze over hun schouder. "Dat wordt jullie dood. Zelf weten."
Neem een stoel. Ik leg even alle boeken neer, die heb ik altijd graag bij me. If you take this chair, that would be...
Did I can't take my water?
Of course you can take your water. We hoorden achtereenvolgens Selina Godden met haar gedicht Titanic, begeleid door Jörg Brinkman op cello en Maarten Ornstein op sampler van Spoken Beat Night. De Irakese schrijver Hassan Blasim, die las uit zijn deze week verschenen boek Lijken tentoonstelling en Tommy Wieringa, die uiteraard las uit zijn roman Dit zijn de namen. En bovendien ziet u twee tekenaars daar aan het werk. Dat zijn Sekou en Flo de Goede. Ze zijn nu even van hun plekken af, maar ze zullen regelmatig tekeningen maken tijdens de gesprekken.
Two different positions in writing about the refugee. You write Tommy from let's say the inside out, and you write from the outside in, and you write from the inside out. Actually, is there a difference in these two positions? And what is the difference? Sure. You have to use your imagination to...
Yes, that's always a bit of a sad position, actually. If you have to live on your imagination. I mean, I've been in this situation before in Sydney, and I felt very awkward to be in the in connection with real-life stories. Fiction feels very poor in that respect. So... Now it's your turn.
Yeah, but it, in the end, it's like I don't write like real story. It's not biography. I write fiction. It's short story. So it's still this, what reality I saw in the road when I crossed the border, just for the audience, I crossed the border from Iraq to arrive to Finland, to Helsinki. I live in Finland. It's take me 4 years. And all the time people, they ask me, how you come, Hassan, to Helsinki? I say, I walking from Baghdad to Helsinki, and it take 4 years to me to arrive, because must I work in the Turkey and Bulgaria and Serbia and Hungary to find money to smuggler. But in the end, I think it's also difficult when you leave something and you want to write it about, because it's not biography. You want to be artist, writer, you play with language, and you know literature. I mean, what you know literature? You read all your life, and you want to be a writer. I would start when I'm young. So when you leave something, your experience is not mean.
I know, but still there's your biography on the back of your book and your connection to this traveling, to this to the road.
Right, yeah. Right, it's still, you use all the material in your life, of course.
But is it, it's still possible to write from that position, from the poor position about this subject?
Yeah, well, you try to, and I mean, that's, you can be saved by a few things, and one of them is good writing. And the other thing is imagination, and the other thing is if tomorrow evening I will be speaking about a book called La Tregua, Het Respijt, from Primo Levi. So I need all these outward sources in order to come to a book like this. So I have to thrive on other sources than you probably.
Yeah, I agree.
Because your experience, despite the fact that you're writing fiction, the experiences you had are very much part of the fiction you write.
Yes, of course, it's part. I mean, it's like this equation, all your life, you're a writer, if you live in Finland or you live in Iraq or you cross the border, you use the material about what you live. It's your life and your imagination and the book what you read, the film what you see, so it's everything. Yeah.
But you're not very much inclined to write a novel about a white man from Helsinki going hunting or something?
No, but because you know now just this story is because I write in Arabic language and now I write novel. My novel is about Helsinki. So there is white people. Yeah. If you want to write about white people, make you happy. I mean, white people, it's like nice. I tell you the story before we come here about the culture, how you meet culture. When I arrived to Finland, for example, about white people, I meet Moroccan man, he's a young guy. I ask him about Finnish society. I ask him, which kind of society, Finnish society? He say, shit. They drink too much. They are depression. They don't talk. I say, shit, same me in Iraq. I drink too much. Yeah, I don't talk, you know. So it's easy to write also about some character from Finland. No problem, you are a writer.
The only difference is the climate. That's what you're trying to say.
You are, you know, it's like most difficult in the life for me, I don't see any difference between people. I mean, between culture, like, really. I don't focus about the difference. So you are personal, you find yourself. So I mean, just I want back to your point. It's, of course, easy to write about some character in Finland.
But of course, no. There's no different. We're all human beings. We all write about what it's like to be a human being in this day and age. But still, your experiences are quite different from most other people.
But my experience. I live in Finland. I live 12 years, so I make route. I know character. I see Finnish character sit in the bar, just look at the beer like half hour. I can't write about that. That's art. Like I mean,
Of course,
yeah.
There's no border, what you could write.
No border, no.
Does it bother you to be called a refugee writer then?
You know, I don't care. Some writer, like, they don't want to be refugee writer. And then in Finland, they ask me, do you are Iraqi writer or Finnish writer because I'm Finnish citizen? I don't spend time to think.
You just want to be a writer?
Yeah, writing, and that's it. Yeah.
And in that domain, you're
maybe this for academic people, the question, did he's a refugee writer? Or his Finnish writer. They can't think, I can't write.
Do you like being a Dutch writer, Tommy?
Yes and no. It's very difficult. Dutch answer. It's probably very, more difficult to be a Dutch writer than an Iraqi writer from Finland or a Finnish writer from Iraq. For in the Netherlands, what Milan Kundera once said, what happened to this aspect, what the novel started with, adventure, and he talked a book, of course, about Don Quixote, and I, which is also a novel about space, enormous, endless space, and these two aspects, we don't have that in the Netherlands. We don't have space and we don't have adventure. So I need to borrow your story in order to write.
I can borrow all your story also. I can write about Finland, a Finnish character.
But you feel limited?
Yes, I feel quite limited in the Netherlands writing here. And I need to travel and I need to go to Ukraine learn horse driving, and I need to go to Morocco to experience some adventure, to experience some...
You can walk 4 years.
Yes, I know.
Right, do that and ride.
I know. Yeah.
But there is obviously something about the subject of the refugee that you want to do something about, something with in your fiction. Early March, there's another book from you coming up.
Yeah.
The Death of Murat Idrissa. Which is also about a refugee.
Yeah, maybe I should change the title because no one has it right until
now.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
So, Idrissi, Murat Idrissi. But I have to change the title. It's terrible.
No, it's just me.
Okay, good. No, but I'm very interested in it. And when I'm in New York, for instance, I always go to the to this Ellis Island Museum because you can feel why people travel there, and you can see these red arrows pointing from Europe to on a map. You can see all these arrows pointing from Europe to the United States, which was at the time a country of hope.
Which kind of country now?
And you can actually listen to. There are these telephones, and you can put them on your ear, and you can listen to these real life stories about. There was, for instance, an 80-year-old woman who told about when she came from Ukraine, went to the United States, and they checked their health, of course, as they did in your story, and on her mother's tongue was a little black spot, so they sent the mother back, And you can hear her voice break when she says, well, we never saw her again. So it's such an amazing, it's a very good museum, actually. And but there's an interesting remark made by Paul Scheffer in his book, De Vrijheid van de Grens, The Freedom of the Border, in which he says, well, only 2% of the people travel, only 2% of the people migrate. The rest of them stays at home, which is an interesting thought. And we always investigate people who migrate, but never people who stay at home.
The ones who stay where they are.
So, yeah. So that's what our new novels will be about, people who stay at home.
That's a very good preliminary conclusion. Thank you very much for now.
Thank you.
Zo dadelijk zijn er nog meer voordrachten, maar eerst gaan we naar Babang Kirkuki.
Je moet nu komen.
Ja, dat is nu
anders. Oh.
Is bijna zover.
Ja.
Wil je teruggaan? Ze vragen mij, ga je terug naar Koerdistan? Als het land stabiel en veilig is. Ik antwoord, als ik ooit naar de baarmoeder terug zou gaan, zal ik geen asiel aanvragen. En geen vlucht voor mijn ziel kiezen. Ik zal mijn lichaam niet laten trillen in de kou. Ik schommel in twee werelden. De ene waar ik nu leef, de andere in mijn dromen. Een land voor mijn paspoort, geschreven in de ladder van hun gemeentekantoor. Mijn andere land ligt in het noorden van mijn hart. Teruggaan. Ze vragen mij, ga je terug naar Koerdistan als het land stabiel en veilig is? Ik antwoord, als ik ooit naar de baarmoeder terug zou gaan, zal ik geen asiel aanvragen en geen vlucht voor mijn ziel kiezen. Ik zal mijn lichaam niet laten trillen in de kou. Ik schommel in twee werelden. De ene waar ik nu leef, de andere in mijn dromen. Een land voor mijn paspoort, geschreven in de ladder van hun gemeentekantoor. Mijn andere land ligt in het noorden van mijn hart, het noorden van mijn hart.
Michal Shishkin, please come forward and read what you prepared for tonight? You're going to read first, I presume, or?
What should I read?
I thought you were going to read a text, but obviously you weren't aware of. You were going
I
to
could read a Russian poem if you like.
Yeah, it's okay.
Is it? I would like to read the poem by my favorite poet, your Joseph Brodsky, if you don't mind. It's better.
No,
than
Joseph Brodsky
than Shishkin.
It's a very good idea, Joseph Brodsky. Please go ahead.
Нынче ветрено. И волны с перехлёстом. Скоро осень, всё изменится в округе. Смена красок этих трогательней постум, чем наряду перемену у подруги. Дева тешит до известного предела. Дальше локтя не пойдёшь или колено. Сколь отраднее, прекрасное вне тела. Ни объятия невозможны, ни измена. Спасибо. Thank you. Знаем мы вас. Сдаетесь, как мученики зимы, а потом воровать. Сколько раз было? Сначала знакомимся на интервью. Здрасте, здрасте. А потом жданная встреча в полиции. Как поймают на воровстве. Толмач ведь и в полиции подрабатывает. О, старые знакомые, давненько-давненько. И опять начинаются страсти-мордасти, мол, директор магазина «Мигра» на выходе указ вовсе не кусал, а если и кусал, то только потому, что тот стал душить. Так вот, вернемся к нашим баранам. Вы на себя посмотрите. До седин дожили, и все в бегах. Где паспорт? Не знаете. А мы знаем. На вокзале, в камере хранения или в беженском хайме у ранее сдавшегося дружка-корешка. Вот оформим вас, получите подорожную по казенной надобности на придуманную фамилию, выйдете и прямиком за документами. Что, не так? Потом устроитесь на всем готовом. И вперед, воровать да скупать по дешевке краденое. Горюет, а сам ворует. Не плут, не картежник, а ночной придорожник. Голодный архиерею крадет. И про работу нам тут мозги не пудрите. Да кому вы здесь нужны? Тут и без вас много желающих. Много званых черномазой, да мало избранных. Здесь в магазине воруете, а там у себя в ларьках продаете. Вот вся ваша работа. Ну и что, что все на сигнализации? Не знаете, что ли, как сумки делать? Это очень просто. Берете алюминиевую фольгу и изнутри приклеиваете. Получается, как отражающий мешок. Никакая сигнализация не сработает. Выноси, что хочешь. Потом переправляете. Как? Да хотя бы по почте. Пишите, мол, подарок, поношенные вещи и прочий дребедень. Тут главный обратный адрес. В телефонной книге найдите кого-нибудь поприличнее. А еще лучше какую-нибудь благотворительную организацию. Никто тогда и не придерется. Понятно? Что значит «не получится»? Глаза боятся, руки делают. Не вы первые, не вы последние. Так что говорите правду и ничего, кроме правды. И не забывайте, что в ваши леденящие кровь истории никто давно не верит. Ведь жизнь состоит еще из любви и красоты. Потому что я сплю, а сердце мое бодрствует. Вот голос моего возлюбленного, который стучится. Отвори мне, сестра моя, возлюбленная моя, голубица моя. Чистая моя, потому что голова моя вся покрыта росою, кудри мои ночной влагою. Вы поняли ваши права и обязанности, и что в рай все равно никого не пустят? ГС. Да. Спасибо.
Die Lage war ernst, denn nun musste auch mein Koffer durchsucht werden. Das übernahmen zwei junge Soldaten, die beide nicht älter als 20 sein konnten. Sie trugen durchsichtige Plastikhandschuhe und machten Scherze, um die Situation aufzulockern. Das Mädchen durchwühlte meine Sachen und versuchte respektvoll, nicht genau hinzuschauen, weshalb sie vom glatzköpfigen Soldaten immer wieder harsch angefahren wurde. Er stand breitbeinig daneben, schaute genau auf den Inhalt des Koffers und gab Anweisungen. Jedes Kleidungsstück, jeder Schal, jede Unterhose wurden auseinandergefaltet, sämtliche Dosen aufgeschraubt, selbst meine elektrische Zahnbürste wurde auf Sprengstoff getestet. Dass ich kaum Kleidung, dafür aber viele Wörterbücher dabei hatte, weckte Misstrauen. Während dieser Untersuchung fand die Befragung statt. Wen kennen Sie in Israel? Bei wem werden Sie wohnen? Für wen werden Sie arbeiten? Worin besteht Ihre Aufgabe? Der Soldat sah mir in die Augen, weshalb ich nach Israel gekommen bin und weshalb ich nicht schon früher gekommen bin und weshalb nicht für immer. Die Soldatin durchsuchte mir den langen, rotlackierten Nägeln, meine Arabisch-Wörterbücher, auch ihr Ton wurde zunehmend aggressiv. Weshalb ich in arabische Länder gereist bin und was ich über den Nahostkonflikt wisse. Sprechen Sie Arabisch? Ja. Weshalb? Ich habe studiert. Sprechen Sie Hebräisch? Nein. Haben Sie einen Freund? Ja, nein. Ich meine nein. Ist er Araber, Ägypter oder Palästinenser? Nein. Was denn dann? Tot. Sie schauten einander irritiert an. Wann ist er verstorben? Fragte die junge Frau schüchtern. Vor kurzem. Das tut mir leid, sagte die Soldatin und zeigte ein kleines Lächeln. Woran ist er gestorben? Fragte der Soldat. An einer Lungenembolie. Bei Araber, Ägypter oder Palästinenser? Als ich noch überlegte, ob mir diese Frage eben tatsächlich gestellt wurde, hörten wir die Durchsage, do not be alarmed by gunshots, because the Israeli security needs to blow up suspicious passenger luggage. Mehrere Schüsse folgten. Das Walkie-Talkie des Glaskopfs klingelte. Er sprach schnell und aufgeregt hinein. Die Soldaten schlossen meinen Koffer. Sie entschuldigten sich für die Untersuchung, sagten, sie sei wegen der Sicherheitssituation nötig gewesen und wünschten mir viel Vergnügen im Heiligen Land. Der Soldat wollte mich überreden, nach Eilat zu fahren. Dort kam er her und kenne jeden Stein. Seine Kollegen unterbrach ihn und erzählte von kleinen Wasserfällen rund um Jerusalem. Sie schoben mir die Busverbindungen vom zentralen Busbahnhof auf, als ein besorgter Offizier auf uns zurannte. Er stellte sich vor und entschuldigte sich ausgesprochen höflich dafür, dass mein Computer soeben gesprengt worden war. Dann führte er mich in einen anderen Raum, wo die Überreste bereits auf einen Tisch aufgebahrt waren. Mein Computer war allerdings nicht wirklich in die Luft gesprengt worden. Das weiße Gehäuse war von 3 Einschusslöchern zerstört. Der Offizier kaute Kaugummi. Wieso haben Sie meinen Computer erschossen? Fragte ich ungläubig. Wir dachten, es wäre eine Bombe. Das ist ein normales Vorgehen bei einem vermuteten terroristischen Anschlag. Vielen Dank.
U hoorde achtereenvolgens de dichter Baban Kirkuki, begeleid door Jörg Brinkman cello, Maarten Ornstein basklarinet, Paul Paulussen gitaar. En u hoorde de Russische schrijver Michal Shishkin, die las uit Venushaar, een roman die, van hem die enige tijd geleden verschenen is. Ik zal ze straks allemaal even laten zien, weten hoe ze eruit zien. En hij las natuurlijk ook een gedicht van Jozef Brodsky. En als laatste de Duits-Azerbaidjaanse Olga Krasnova, die las uit haar roman Een Rus is iemand die van berken houdt. En u ziet overigens ook nog steeds de tekeningen zo dadelijk weer van Sekou en van Flo de Goede. Welcome, both of you. Mr. Shishkin, you say in another book that's been published, The Calligraphy Less, it's called in Dutch, that there's something intrinsically untranslatable in a language. That there's something you can't, you can never translate, you can never bring without the language. Does that also mean that if you live in another country and not actively a part of that language, that something of you is not translatable anymore?
No, nobody can be translated, yeah, because not because of the language. You see, actually, every novel I compare it with the Titanic, and every translation is an iceberg. And you know what happens. And some characters, some ideas, some stories can survive, But
and the iceberg is the translators.
The translation, yeah.
Yeah, the translation. So the translation always wins, despite the thickness of the metal.
No, actually, the translation, the need of translation, is the evil for the literature. But there is no other way. There is no other way just through the words, just through the translation. So you have to choose between two evils, not to be translated or to be translated. I choose always the translation, yeah.
It would be a very strange choice not to try to choose translation, would it? You're not so sure of that, Tommy. That would be a strange choice.
No, I can actually imagine choosing not to be translated. I had some very bad experiences in foreign countries, and I thought, I wish my novel was never translated here. So I can actually relate to that, yes.
Just one example, so you understand what I mean. When my novel was translated into English, so my publisher sent me three sample translations. Just the same piece of text translated by three different translators. And comparing, I was absolutely astonished, yeah? No one sentence, no sentence was the same, yeah? So it means, not because one translator was better, yeah? Because there are three different personalities with different ideas, with different tastes, with different background. So if everybody had the possibility to translate my novel, I would have three different novels in English.
Olga, you're a main character in the novel. Here it is. Een Rus is iemand die van berken houdt. That's someone who says you could live everywhere, anywhere. She has that something to do with the talent for languages she has also?
I mean, she's working as an interpreter, so it's her ability to live everywhere as long as she can master the language. But also her master of language, it's not an artistic one, it's just it's a barking access to the language, and I think it's something totally different.
Yeah, in what way is it different?
In the way that you, when you're interpreting, as far as I know, you just try to translate a sentence as fast as you can and as accurate as you can. But you're not sitting in your room for days and thinking what would be the best solution or which connotations are awakening in this. It has to be very quick.
You have to translate instantly instead of being able to think about it for a long time.
To think about the whole context, because you're just translating sentence by sentence.
But the concept of a home for your character in this book is quite difficult, isn't it? It's she lives in Germany. She's Jewish, but comes from a faraway country. She fled from quite a violent country. What does it do to her sense of identity in the book?
Nothing, actually. She's quite happy. It's not her. It's funny.
Is it a generation ability to be despite all that being able to live everywhere and not to feel displaced?
It's in general a question of our age, what we mean when we say home, and which generation defines home in which way, or which country, and especially which political direction and which political party is defining homeland and home, and who belongs to this homeland and who's not. For me, it's rather a political question, how we use the word homeland and how we treat people who are not, who don't belong to this home, rather than a question of feelings. I think the feelings are always something we manipulate to achieve our political goals, speaking of these matters. For example, in Germany, every time you can hear somebody speaking about Heimat, you can know that something will go horribly wrong the next instant. And it's the same in Russia. Like, in general, if people are talking on stage or somewhere else and they're referring to their home country, it's not a good sign. It's rather a sign to run.
So it would be a good thing for all of us to feel displaced in a sense.
I mean, there's a very nice saying, which was, there was a Jewish author. It's a shame, but now I forgot it.
I got it. It's Isaac Deutsche, when he was asking about roots and where his roots would be, he just said, Jews don't have roots, we have legs. So I think it's accurate for most of the people.
Do you recognize yourself in Olga's story, Hassan?
What?
Do you recognize yourself in the story she just told?
Yeah, of course. I agree totally. And I just beg about the translator question. I choose both devil because I, in the short story, I agree translator, but I never agree translator my poem. So you can choose about that. Yes, I also write poem about it. It's like our root, our this funny short nightmare life. And that's our root, I mean.
This funny what? This funny?
It's funny nightmare.
A funny nightmare?
Yes.
That's what life is, a funny nightmare.
Of course, yeah. And no, life is, you can't say nightmare. Life, yes. It's easy. You can't put any word beside life.
Is life a funny nightmare or is fiction a funny nightmare?
It's if you put any word beside the life word, like life, dance, life, traveling, life, it's working. So that's the nightmare. Because life meaning all this.
So life is a nightmare.
I think for me it's a nightmare because you imagine if somebody born in Iraq, I think it's a nightmare.
And
maybe if you're born here, it's different. It's a dream, it's nice, but in Iraq, it's a nightmare, of course.
And that nightmare will never go away anymore, despite the fact that you live in a fairly safe country as Finland.
It's go away when we destroy this earth and life disappears. So I think it's
we have to destroy life on earth in order to make the nightmare go away.
But we do that all the time. We destroy the world. And we created the nightmare, like nightmare now in Europe. Yeah. Refugee situation, everything is nightmare. People talking about Trump, but we don't want to talk about politicians now, but it's nightmare, of course. There are a lot of people suffering in this world. It's few people, they have good life in this earth.
But the nightmare is outside of Europe, isn't it?
Huh?
The nightmare is outside of Europe, isn't it? And we're protecting...
Of course, because you talk here about refugees.
We're protecting the good dream we're having here.
For example, you talk just, I just give example. You talk in Europe here just about refugee, the problem about now, like Syria. Refugee coming more and more refugee to Europe because must we practicing how more people coming from climate change to Europe and for other reasons. There is many more coming. It's just beginning now. So that's like nightmare because now the capitalism Europe pay big price, destroyed many nations and all this nation come here. And me, like activist, I always say at the time, say people in Africa and say work smuggler, bring all people to Europe, occupy the bank, because how they destroyed your country, it's nightmare.
We have to bring?
They bring all the people, poor people. When the
all poor people to Europe?
Yes, yes, yeah.
And what will happen to Europe if we do that?
Sounds like a very good idea, sir.
It's like, because, you know, for me, I don't see the 1,000 people come to Europe. They are not refugee. It's a huge demonstration against capitalism. It's a demonstration.
The refugees?
Yes. They, of course, you ask refugees, they go out from the war. But it's like, it's demonstration against capitalism. It's a different story. So it's coming more and more, and that's big, huge nightmare. And all the time, refugee and people, when move from place to change the history. So I see refugee, they're coming more from Yemen, from many, many different countries. So that's like kind of revolution and nightmare, of course, for Europe and many people around the world.
Michael and Olga, I see you quite not really reacting to it. What do you think about what you just said?
No, I know the situation from the other side. Yeah, I was not a refugee, but many years I worked as an interpreter for migration office in Switzerland, and I saw how it works. So it's actually the Ministry of Defense defending Switzerland, defending Europe from the refugees. And the main idea is just to find the possibility not to give the asylum. And I had to translate from Russian. So these were people from the former Soviet Union, from all republics around Russia. And you see, it's a very bad job. Good job is you. If you are tired, you come home bed late at night, have dinner with your family, and you could say some funny things which happened to you. But there were no funny stories there. And you have all these stories in your heart, and you bring them home. And the only possibility for me was to write. And so I wrote this novel, Maidenhair, Venus Hair. After it has been published, I lost my job at once. No, I can understand which organization wants to have a writer as an interpreter. Yeah, interpreter must be just invisible, yeah, just the air. Yeah. So since that time, I just have to live with my books. But
isn't there also an element of cruelness in the fact that you had to work as an interpreter? It makes you part of the machinery of that system.
I saw it's not the job for normal officers there too. If they work with the heart, not like a roboter, they burn out very quickly and they leave. And the only possibility to stay there is to become a roboter. Yeah? And so they explain to themselves, I just ask questions and put down the answers. And I sent it to Bern, to the capital. Yeah? And they decide. And people in Bern, they take the answers and the questions. Oh, it's everything is clear. Yeah, no. Yeah. So nobody wants to have this personal responsibility because it hurts, because it is living people. Yeah. And it's a bad job. It's a bad job. Yeah.
And a beautiful novel that you've written about it.
Sorry.
And a beautiful novel that you've written about it. Maybe that's...
You see, this book is full of cruelties.
It is.
Because our life is full of cruelties. We just don't want to see them. It's normal. It's human not to see the cruel things. But it is life. It is real life. And the book is not about cruelties. The book is about overcoming of cruelties. And Venus Hair, it is actually a weed. Yeah, Adiantus Capillis Veneris. Yeah. And this weed is in Rome, yeah, everywhere, on the ruins. But in Russia, it is a house plant, because in Russian winter it will die. So it can survive only with human warmth. It is the book about the overcoming of all the cruelties with love, with human warmth. Well, that is what is the book about.
Overcoming cruelty is a definition of fiction. Maybe. Thank you very much that you were here. Dit is het boek van Michal Shishkin, Venus Haar, waarin hij die ervaring als tolk heeft verwerkt. Het boek van Oren Kesha, een Rus is iemand, Steven Berkhout, dat is dit boek. En bovendien dat van Hassan, dat is vandaag uitgekomen, lijkt tentoonstelling. En dat, hij zal het straks hierachter signeren. En dit zijn de namen uiteraard van Tommy Wieringa. Als u dat nog niet gelezen heeft, dan moet u dat spoorslags doen. Hartelijk dank. And thank you for my guests.